people depend on Subaru Wagon Engine in America. And with Goodson, they're reliable and durable. In fact, if Subaru didn't make your life easier...
Honey, is dinner ready?
Who would? Subaru. We built our reputation by building a better car.
We would like to reassure all parents who are expecting a child. Relax. Your child's delivery is in the right hands. TWA's child care program. Even before you get on the plane, our in-flight service manager is working to make you comfortable.
A child traveling alone in row 18, and we'll need a vegetarian meal in row 10. And Tony, make sure we have enough...
Today's TWA. Find out how good we really are.
The number one fitness exercise in the world is cross-country skiing. And now it can be duplicated in your home with Easy Glider. Just 20 minutes every other day, an hour a week, is all it takes to strengthen and firm all major muscle groups and lose weight aerobically. You'll burn up to 400 calories per workout, plus tone chest, arms and back, calves, thighs and buttocks. Notice the quality construction of the sturdy metal frame. This handsome unit folds down quickly for easy storage. Other ski simulators cost as much as $500, but Easy Glider is just $59.95, and your satisfaction is absolutely guaranteed. Grab the bargain. Call toll-free now.
To order your Easy Glider, call 1-800-248-4422. Use your credit card to avoid COD charges or send check or money order for $59.95 plus $9 shipping and handling to Easy Glider, care of TV offer, P.O. Box 10020, Stamford, Connecticut, 06904.
A view of the White House in downtown Washington, D.C., and just a few miles east here in Landover, Maryland, the Washington Capitals of the Philadelphia Flyers are headed for overtime. Tied after regulation time, tied in this series. And as you can see on the scoreboard, the Flyers 4, the Capitals 4. We are headed to overtime. Again, the Washington Capitals must decide their fate in the seventh and final game in overtime. Welcome back. I'm Jeff Rimmer, and it's a pleasure to have with us from USA Today their television and radio critic, Rudy Martsky. And Rudy, we say, or we assume, understanding from our producer, Bill Brown, with five telecasts in the building here tonight, over 55 million people at least tuning into tonight's hockey game. And are they seeing a good game?
Well, they're seeing probably, obviously, the best game of the series. You got an overtime game. You got a city of Washington that is waiting to see what happens to these Capitals. Do they actually ever come back and win a big one? Or do they lose and fade into oblivion again and possibly a shakeup for the franchise? It's pretty thrilling to be here.
As you saw, and I guess you're sitting in on a couple of the other town telecasts, a lot of interest in this hockey game, and certainly a lot of interest right across the country, and of course north of the border, tremendous interest in hockey. But games like this, you've got to do a lot for hockey in this area, and again, nationally.
Well, I always contend that there's about 20,000 people in Washington that care about hockey. They all go to the Capitals games. They're the same people there every week for every game. And I think it's great if they can finally win a series and get into the next round. And I think there'll be a lot more hockey fans developed in this city.
Now, you've written in your coverage this week in USA Today, in your column, that there seems to be some tremendous interest right now in hockey on ESPN and their coverage.
Yes, it's, I don't know what the actual reason is, but ESPN's ratings have been about double what they were in the past. They're getting 500,000 or plus homes, whereas in the past they only got about 250,000 homes per game. So it's, for some reason, this is the year that hockey has taken off around the country for cable.
Do you think that the National Hockey League will ever have a national network contract?
No, I don't think you'll ever go back to that again. As people know, they used to have it on a couple of networks, on NBC and CBS years ago, but there just isn't enough national interest, especially in the South and the West, to support hockey on a network.
Okay, well, what do games like this do for exposure and for interest in hockey? Of course, we talk in terms of the Olympics, your coverage extensive during the Olympic Games, team talking, or at least the USA talking about Team USA, and they kind of, ABC hung their hats on the U.S. hockey team.
I think this game is good for the local Washington area, let's say Philadelphia area. Now, this game is going on ESPN, so that the nation is seeing this, but I don't know if it's brought that many more viewers to the set, because either you're a hockey fan or you're not one. I think it's got more of an impact in Washington and Philadelphia.
Of course, home team sports very much involved with Baltimore Orioles baseball. And people right across the country that do have dishes get a chance to watch Orioles baseball coverage. And you've been very, very complimentary about the coverage on home team sports, hockey and baseball. Why?
Well, I took off my ESPN pin that I was wearing earlier, and I get a chance to get these home team sports.
You want mine right now?
But no, I've written this, that home team sports does do a very good job on baseball and the Orioles. In fact, a couple of network people have mentioned it to me, and I think they've tried to pick up a couple of angles that they use on air games now. Home team sports, let's say right field and so on angles.
Of course, it's a credit to the people that are involved behind the scenes, and not coincidentally, they're also involved in our hockey coverage, and Bill Brown and Sheldon Schimmer and the entire crew. It's basically the same crew that's here in Washington for hockey and moved down the road for Baltimore baseball.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Are you impressed with what you see from an Orioles perspective, and do you expect HTS to get some accolades with an Orioles ball club that may be off to a slow start?
I don't know if HGS, I don't know who can get any accolades on the Orioles. I mean, I think it's right now you should get the Courage Award for actually showing up and doing their games.
Who's going to win this hockey game? Give me a prediction.
I think it's the destiny of the Capitals to somehow come out strong in this third period and score, the overtime and score a goal. And having stood out there during part of the game, these fans will go nuts. But it's been a long time coming for them, and I think they deserve it. I mean, let's face it, the Flyers have already had several Stanley Cups, so why shouldn't it be Washington's turn?
Rudy, they really give guys like you in the newspaper business something to write about and really be a good catch. The Capitals coming from behind in the series, coming from behind tonight, and then winning this game in overtime, something they did not do last year in losing to the Islanders. Thanks for the visit.
Okay, thank you.
Stay tuned. We've got overtime upcoming here on Home Team Sports. The Capitals and the Flyers tied in the series, tied on the scoreboard. Stay tuned.
Up at 4-4, the Washington Capitals and the Philadelphia Flyers here in Game 7. Sudden death overtime is now a reality. Mike Foran's welcoming you back to our Home Team Sports telecast along with Al Koken and Jeff Rimmer. And yes, we've been through this before, but this time it's not the Capitals who are sitting here. Remember a year ago we were talking about this situation and the point kept coming up. The Capitals should not be in this situation in the first place. They had the Flyers down 3-1. And they should not have had to go through this in the first place. They never should have allowed the Islanders back into this series. This time it's Washington who has come from 3-1 down and down 3-0 in this game. And the Flyers have to be thinking that way a little bit right now, I would think, not only in terms of the series, but in terms of this game. The Caps took the lead briefly in that period. The Flyers tied it up. Let's check our TWA shot chart right now and show you the Washington shots during the third period of this hockey game. The Capitals with 9 shots, and they scored once. Dale Hunter got the goal.
Well, very little going on in front of Ron Hextall in that slot area, although Scott Stevens did have a great chance late in the period. The Flyers, as you knew they would, really regrouped nicely. But Dale Hunter made the big play as far as the Capitals were concerned, gave them what proved to be a rather brief lead. It starts with the Gary Galley shot. Hextall thought it was coming through. Hunter stops it and then snaps a quick shot while Hextall was down with the stick almost flat out on the ice. Hunter's fourth of the year. Galley and Hatcher with the assist. And remember the key to that, Mike? The Capitals winning a faceoff. Dale Hunter doing the job. But we'll see at the other end with the Flyer goal. It's Peter Zezel who beats Hunter. And that key is what Brad Marsh was able to accomplish.
He sure was. And the Flyers, you notice during the third period, had an awful lot of two-on-ones, three-on-two breaks. Situations that developed that I think the Capitals would really rather not allow once we get to sudden death overtime. We'll see their side now of the shot chart brought to you as well by TWA. And the Flyers also 9 shots and 1 goal. And Marsh's boomer from the blue line was the lone scorer for Philadelphia.
Well, if you're Pete Peters, you really couldn't have asked for any more in terms of where people were moved out, except on this play. One of the view times tonight, there was plenty of traffic in front of Peters. The faceoff is won. There comes Brad Marsh. Now, the shot is low. It may have ticked off somebody that's changed direction slightly, but there's no question there was 5 different people in front of Pete Peters. It's almost impossible to see a shot like that coming through, and it's the shot you expect out of a veteran like Brad Marsh. Not booming, not real hard in terms of the velocity, but very accurate. Low and on the net, where something good can happen.
Look from that angle like it might even have hit Dale Hunter as he was backing in there trying to get away from in front of the net, pushing someone out. It possibly could have gone off him, but the goal belongs to Brad Marsh. Now, we could talk to you about overtime records right now. We could say something like, during the regular season, the Capitals two wins, four losses, nine ties in overtime. We could talk about the Flyers, one win, three losses, and nine ties. The Capitals beat the Flyers during regular season in overtime, but the Flyers beat the Capitals once in overtime already here during postseason play. I think the only overtime the Capitals want to think about right now is last year. And we have not seen the goaltending on both sides that we saw last year between Bob Mason and Kelly Rudy. Somebody's going to score a goal. I don't think it's going to take any four overtimes like it did last year.
I remember last year in the overtime, the Capitals came out and really took it to Rudy. Rudy may have played his best in that first and second overtime. They put plenty of pressure on him. I think, again, they feel if they do the same thing, they can get it by Hextall.
All right, let's check in downstairs now with Jeff Rimmer.
Thanks, Mike. People around ice level here talking in terms of who's going to score the overtime goal, be it for the Flyers or the Washington Capitals. Well, there are many character players on both sides, but many of the people around here, in fact, I suggest if you have to pick a player from either team, you look at the Washington Capitals, a guy that's been through overtime before, and a guy that scored a big series overtime goal to clinch it for the Quebec Nordiques in a series against the Montreal Canadiens that I recall. Dale Hunter is the guy that I pick off from Montreal or off the Washington Capitals. If you had to look at the Philadelphia Flyers, how about their team captain, Dave Poulin? I don't think, along with Mike Forns and Al Koken, that we're headed for four overtimes. Watch out for those two guys here in the overtime. Poulin for the Flyers and Dale Hunter. Let's hope it's Hunter. We've got overtime for you. Mike Forns and Al Koken set to bring you all the excitement of overtime hockey. One goal will decide this series. Here's Mike and Al.
Okay, thanks very much, Jeff. I think good choices by Jeff Rimmer, people to keep a focus on. And here's something that comes in also, Mike, in terms of how rested is each defense corps. Mike Keenan, notorious for basically cutting down to four defensemen, saw very little except some power play time for Carey Hoffman. Very, very little ice time for Greg Smith. That means basically four defensemen had gone for Mike Keenan. The Capitals lost Grant Ledyard early. Gary Galley made some regular moves out there along with Larry Murphy. So at least Brian Murray was able to go with five. And we'll see if that becomes a factor. And particularly if the Capitals are able to go after the Marsh and Crossman duo. Howe and Samuelson will start it out. But when Marsh and Crossman have been out there, the Capitals have gotten some good forechecking pressure established, particularly from the line of Gustafson, Pavanka, and Christie.
They're all wearing white, shaking white pom-poms, and they're standing here in Landover, Maryland at the Capitol Center. And we're ready to go with sudden death overtime. Remember, the Capitals have used their timeout. Philadelphia still has their timeout available. Mark Howe's long shot tipped off Peter's glove and goes behind the net. Here's Langway up the glass and out of the zone to center ice. Samuelson to start back, crosses it in. Hughes roadblocks and leads it over to Rod Langway. The Flyers forechecking right away. Poulin's in there. Along with Propp, but the Capitals come out. Michael Pavanka, three on two. He's got Gustafson and Christian. The pass goes behind Christian, and the Capitals are offside. Now Tocca gives a cross check to Pavanka. And behind the net, it goes undetected. Well, considering what we saw late in the third period, talking about penalties being called, even though there have been a lot of penalties called in overtime so far, comparatively this year, compared with other Stanley Cup playoff series, I don't expect anything called tonight. I don't know how you feel about it. I just don't look for anything to be called. I don't think there's going to be anything called. And I should go on record as saying this, too. If I had to handpick the officials I would want working this game, I would have said Don Koharski, Ron Finn, Bob Hodges.
I agree with you. I will still give Koharski the benefit of the doubt and say if something major happens, he will call it, although it didn't seem to appear that was going to be his bend in the final half of that period. Called a couple early, both for hooking and tripping.
Here's Gartner, a slap shot, and a stick save by Hextall. Now over to Stevens. Back to Mike Ridley. He's held up by Samuelson behind the goal. The puck cleared over the glass and into the seat.
Notice here, Mike Keenan splits his top duo on defense of Samuelson and Howe, keeps Samuelson out there along with Brad Marsh.
Yeah.
just the different traditions both teams have to work with. The Capitals really with no great tradition. Philadelphia has it all, and maybe that will make the difference, as it was for the New York Islanders. Even though there were a lot of young Islander players last year, they felt that they had that Islander jersey on and it was something they could carry with them. This is where the Capitals have to build now.
They score a goal and it's going to start, believe me. Here's Samuelson, left wing side. Craven a shot. Peters a stick save. Back to the corner. Miller jams up with Samuelson. The puck thrown all the way to the point. Dezel a drive wide. And now Murphy goes back to get it. Off the sideboard, down to center. Gartner breaks away. He's hooked and pulled to the ice. There's a penalty call coming. Well, when I said there wouldn't be anything called, I'll guarantee you I did not count on anything as obvious as that coming along. 2 minutes for hooking. Washington has a power play in overtime.
And the last time they had the power play, Hunter with the score. Now look at the step that Mike Gartner almost gets completely. On Howe. And I don't think Howe was going to have to do anything because it looks like Hextall was going to be able to play it. But Gartner goes down, Kaharski's arm straight up immediately. And now the Capitals have a power play to win the game. And boy, this is awful tough to be in that position, though. I almost think it may be better to be the penalty killer in this situation.
Does Brian Murray wish he had that timeout right now?
Maybe. Yeah, maybe, because he's really trying to calm his team down and talk to him. Here, they really feel like the game is in their hands, and sometimes you overcompensate, and the penalty killers can just tee off now. I'll guarantee you no second penalty is going to get called on the Flyers.
At the point, here's Stevens over to Christian. He shoots wide. Pavonka has it knocked down. In front. It's played in front. A shot by Christian. A save. A rebound shot. That's fired wide. The puck's still inside the zone. It's cleared along the boards for Christian. Christian with it. Over to Stevens. Right side, Larry Murphy. Murphy, rink wide, goes to Christian. At the side of the net, it's trapped, it's loose, and it's picked up, but the whistle has already blown, and play has stopped. The puck lay loose right against the side of the goalpost and was picked up by Shel Samuelson, but the whistle had already blown to stop play.
Oh, what glorious chances to start this power play. Capitals get it in the zone, keep it there, and had Hextall spinning. Again, pucks going off skates and sticks in front. Easily could have deflected in. Instead, they deflect themselves wide. Christian firing. Hextall getting a piece of it. Knocked down by prop is David Christian, but the Capitals kept the pressure up.
Now, this looks good. A minute 34 left on the power play. Tons of pressure already mounted with Mark Howe in the box for hooking. You lose a great penalty killer with an offensive player. All-around great player when you've got Mark Howe off the ice. And the Flyers now have Samuelson on with March. Gustafson with Christian and Pavonka for the Capitals with Stevens and Murphy. We're in sudden death overtime. The game tied at 4. Scott Stevens, a shot, breaks his stick. The puck cleared to the blue line. Kept in by Murphy. Stevens goes over for new lumber. And the Caps get away with it. Murphy, a high drive that caroms all the way out to center. And Stevens is able to get a new stick. Here comes Stevens winding it up. Now starts to the blue line. Out to Michael Pavonka at center ice. And it's picked away by Murray Craven and cleared all the way down. A minute to go in the power play attack. Here comes Pavonka to center. Right side Murphy. At the point. Dave Christian sends it to the goal. Pavonka backhander knocked down. Hextall swings and misses. And it's sent out by Sutter. Peters to play it. Slides it over to Stevens and barely got it to him. It was almost picked off by Sutter. Now Ridley back to the blue line. Into the corner for Hatcher. 35 seconds left on the power play. The Flyers clear it again. First 25 seconds of the power play has turned out to be the strongest for the Capitals. But here comes Stevens in. He's hooked to the ice by Samuelson. A shot. Oh, a shot. Oh, another one wide. Gartner hit the goalpost. And the rebound went wide. The puck cleared down. Here comes Prop alone. He shoots. Peters is saved. Captain Mark Howe's penalty, and we saw it at both ends of the ice. This is the last one, the Philadelphia chance, as the Capitals were trying desperately to bang anything in. Prop on the off wing. Peters makes the initial save and then covers up on the Prop rebound. But the Capitals had 3-on-1 in front. Ridley with the perfect pass, and watch, it hits the crossbar. And then the bouncing puck is there for Hunter. He can't get it. Then it's sent wide. The Capitals' glorious opportunities. The crossbar, the goal post, fight back at him again. Oh, you couldn't have worked that any better. You had it on the man who led you in goal scored. He put a great shot on and gets the crossbar. Then a guy who's so good in front, Dale Hunter, the puck just bouncing over his stick.
Here's Hatcher behind the net. Starts out on the attack. The Flyers at full strength. They've got Mark Howe back. Hunter across the line. Has a poke check by Howe, but it's still in the Flyers zone. Marsh clears it out. Langway takes over. Up to Hatcher. He dumps it in. Hunter to the corner, and now Eklund walks it in front of the goal. The Caps have had all the scoring chances, save that last break by Prop. Langway and Eklund tie up in front of the net. And now the Flyers offside as Crossman took it out of the zone and sent it back in with Kerr still in Washington ice.
Three goal posts.
Don't remind me.
So Mike Keenan has got to feel like he's got nine lives to work with. The Capitals in the 4-4 game could have ended it wide open. And now does this discourage Washington? Does it add more determination to their attack? Does this lift up the Flyers feeling they have dodged the biggest bullet of all possible? Brian Murray, what can you say? Now, you know, I'll guarantee you there are going to be a ton of people who would blame Brian Murray if the Capitals would lose this. How can you blame a coach when you've got a 3-on-1 and the puck goes off a crossbar?
It's like they're saying he's the crossbar. Here's Langway. Over to Hatcher. Bounces it back into the Flyers zone. Kel Samuelson, shot blocked by Langway. And Hatcher sends it off the glass. Langway steers it to the blue line. Ridley, right wing side. Here comes Mike Gartner, cutting in. Gartner, a deke, a shot, and a great save by Hextall, stopping Sundstrom from point blank range. Here's Ridley to try and dig it out again. Mike Ridley, over to Gartner. He's held up against the sideboards by Samuelson, and the puck pops over the glass into the crowd. It's gonna take.
All of a sudden, the guy has been shaky almost the entire series, and he comes up with truly a vintage save. This is as good as anything you'll see. Look how he's still got the momentum to anticipate the pass and makes the save on a good shot by Peterson.
He hasn't made a save like that all night.
I agree, Mike. He hasn't made a save like this all series. Gartner does the right thing, gets everybody to him, and there is Hextall showing you exactly why Mike Keenan is going to play him tonight. Why he stuck with him, the type of goaltending you get from a great player, and let's face it, Ron Hextall has proven to me over the first couple of years of his career, he has got greatness in his blood. That is what you say when you talk about game-saving goaltending. I'll criticize myself for a statement like that. The game is on the line. Here you get a guy with a save. That's unbelievable.
More chances for the Washington Capitals. Faceoff inside the Flyer zone. Gustafson to work the draw. Now we've got Pavanka and Mellenby starting to push and shove. Koharski steps in to deliver a warning. To go in sudden death overtime number one. Here's Scott Stevens, and he passes to the point man. Galley is well out of the zone. He cranks it back off the glass, back inside Flyers territory. The late offside underway here. If the Capitals touch the puck, and as they do, Pavanka touching it off Mellenby's stick. Washington finally called offside.
Philadelphia has three shots on goal in sudden death overtime. And the Capitals have five. Gustafson against Poulin. The draw back to Stevens. Over to Murphy. He drives it in. Hextall leaves it for Howe behind the net. Mark Howe rushes to center. Poulin to Kerr on the right wing. Wrist shot blocked by Stevens into the corner. Here's Larry Murphy. Back of the net. Up the right wing now for Dave Christian. Christian sends it back inside Philadelphia ice. Pavonka to the corner. Throws it across the front of the goal mouth. And Gustafson goes to the boards after it. Over to Dave Christian. Christian just missing Pavonka in front. Here's a shot by Stevens and a save. And Hextall covers it to stop play.
The fans booing because Shel Samuelson tackled Michael Pavonka in front. Nothing called by Koharski, but the Caps keep the pressure up. This was shot by Scott Stevens. Catches Hextall very high, right up there, high chest area. You see how Pavonka is tackled. That's after the puck passes him by, and there comes the high drive that catches Hextall right around the neck area, right in the chest. Don Koharski not allowing, I think, Rick Tocchet to come on the ice on this change. Brian Murray now is changing up his units. Tocchet is being sent back to the bench. Now Gould, Hunter, Greg Adams will be the forward line. Stevens and Murphy remain out there as the defense pairing. Poulin had gone off. Keenan wanted to replace him with Tocchet. That was not allowed. So Poulin stays out there, along with Murray Craven, Ilkka Sinisalo, and the defense pairing of Howe and Samuelson.
The draw goes to the corner. Adams ties up with Samuelson. Bobby Gould over to dig it out. Throws it behind the net. Adams crunched by Samuelson on the play. The puck centered. A shot and a save by Hextall. Robbing Bobby Gould from point blank range on a backhander. The puck cleared all the way down. Murphy's after it in the corner. Craven jams up. And Gould works it free. Here come the Capitals. 4-on-3 on the rush. Gould across the line. Fired. Save to Hextall. And the puck left right in front, but only Murray Craven is there. Craven to the blue line. Poke check by Murphy. Murphy starts the rush. He hits Hunter. He's in alone. A shot and a goal! Flyers and the Capitals had the same records during the regular season. Each team with 38 wins, 33 losses, 9 ties. The Capitals won the regular season series 4-2 with a tie on the last day of the regular season. And that entitled them to finish second. That gave them this home ice advantage, meaning that this game was played here in this building. And the monkey is finally off their backs. The Washington Capitals have won a big game before a sold-out crowd against the Philadelphia Flyers in the playoffs. Everything that happened 1 year ago tonight is all worthwhile. It's like they were dues that had to be paid. Here's Hunter scoring the game-winning goal.
Mike, how about the play, though, by Larry Murphy? Look at the alertness. He gets the puck and a perfect pass. Jeff Rimmer called it the man to watch for, Dale Hunter. This is why he was acquired. Puts a couple moves right between the pads to send out those demons that have haunted this franchise since the inception.
Is this the bigger one than the one in Montreal against with Quebec?
Both of them rank up right the same when you score the overtime goal in the seventh game, so quite a thrill for me.
Is there any question as to whether or not the Washington Capitals have character anymore?
Well, we're not chokers anyways. We showed that we're not chokers. We can come back.
All right, Dale, maybe you can describe. We're going to get a look at that goal right now. You can describe it for us on the camera.
Well, I was going in on him. I didn't know what I was going to do until the last second, and I seen a little opening between his legs, and I just thread it through a little bit and slip through his legs.
What is it? Dale Hunter with that overtime goal, and we have more of our post-game show, so stay right here with us. Let's go upstairs to Mike and Al.
All right, Jeff, thanks. Let's take another look at it. Now watch where Murphy's positioned. He will follow the puck up the boards. Well, this is a different play. This is not the overtime winner. This may be one of the great saves that Ron Hextall makes as that puck comes out in front. Hextall pretty routine there, although he was spectacular in the overtime. But I tell you, you know, you talk about guys who have been haunted, members of teams that have taken abuse. Could anything be sweeter for Larry Murphy than having the can in that overtime goal? Alertly came up with the puck and made the absolute perfect pass to Dale Hunter. His only point of the series. And in many ways, Larry Murphy typified the struggle the Capitals have gone under. The fans doubting his character, his talent, and doing the same thing for the team. And in one fell swoop, Larry Murphy and the Capitals answer back to the critics. Craven tries to keep it in, but there's Murphy. Now he makes a move, he's got the head up all the way, and there goes Dale Hunter to the open space. Remember, Howe and Samuelson not out on the ice. Victimized, I think it definitely Crosby and maybe even Marsh, as the Capitals have on many situations in the second half of this series.
Let's go back to last summer at the June draft and a trade made that brings Dale Hunter to the Washington Capitals. We've long said the Caps got him to play against the Flyers, but it was for a different reason than this.
Exactly. Right there, makes the move. Hextall, the big goaltender, when he does open up those pads, there's an ocean full of room, and Dale Hunter buried it in that ocean.
We'll continue with our post-game coverage of the Capitals' victory after this. Tickets are available for games E and F, which are games 1 and 2 of the Patrick Division Finals, on Monday and Wednesday night at 7:30 p.m. You can call Phone Charge at 432-0200, and in Baltimore, the number is 481-6000. Final score tonight, in sudden death overtime, the Capitals win 5-4 over the Philadelphia Flyers. Mike Forens welcoming you back along with Al Kokin. The Capitals win this Patrick Division semifinal round 4-3. The Monkeys off their backs. They're now winners. They can go on and play the New Jersey Devils. And who knows what's going to happen from there, but nothing would have happened had they not gotten out of this first round. And wouldn't you know, it would come down to a a seventh game, wouldn't you know it would be against the Flyers in an overtime situation. You know, they paid some dues a year ago against those New York Islanders when the Islanders win, and now those dues are considered paid.
But they went after the Flyers. That's the thing you have to be so impressed about in that overtime. They could have felt demoralized. They could have felt like, oh, no, not again. And even more so when Ron Hextall started to come up with the type of saves that Kelly Rudy threw in their face. But instead, they just kept at him. No defensive play from Dale Hunter. He saw the opening. He went. Larry Murphy kept his head up and ended everything. You have to admire the way the Capitals attacked and attacked and attacked despite the possibilities of frustration. They came right on and after him.
The Capitals outshot the Flyers 8-3 during the overtime, and you just had the impression all along that they were eventually going to get the game winner. That's the type of pressure they had on the Flyers in the extra session.
That is, and you have to also go give credit to that Capitals defense. There were times when the Flyers counterattacked well, but they let Pete Peters see the shot and cleared the rebound and got it out of the zone, as the Flyers did to start that third period. Remember how Philly came out? They really kind of took the attack to the Capitals. They did not allow the Flyers to get that done again in the overtime, so you got to give a lot of credit to the Capitals' defense as well for foiling that forechecking pressure.
Okay, let's check in right now with Jeff Rimmer.
Thanks, Al. With me, the general manager and vice president of the Washington Capitals. Just a great victory, and David, the Capitals wanted to prove once and for all that they could come from behind, not only in the series, but in this hockey game. They gave you some anxious moments, but they did it in the end.
Well, it was it's unbelievable. I guess we never do anything easy. I mean, it was just incredible. I came down and talked to coaches after the third period, and I said, I guess this is the way it had to be. It's 2 days short of a year that we were in the same situation when we finally lost to the Islanders, and you know, personally, it's been a long year, and I think we finally put that behind us, and we're on to bigger and better things, and it was great. We had so many chances in overtime. I just thought we deserved it, and I'm talking a lot, but I'm speechless.
Is there any question about the character of this hockey team anymore?
Well, there never was, I don't think, in my mind. Again, I don't like to believe in luck and what have you, but we certainly haven't been getting many breaks in key games. And, you know, tonight, I mean, how many times did you come from behind 3-0? And we did it tonight and won a big game in overtime. So let's move on to New Jersey on Monday.
The last question, Dale Hunter. Give me a few words on him.
Well, June at the draft, I must admit, and it was written at that time and said that we got Dale Hunter to make a difference for us in the Patrick division and in the playoffs. And again, who is a better player for the Capitals in the playoffs than Dale Hunter? And he came through tonight not only with the winning goal, but the fourth goal, the go-ahead goal at that time. And he's a winner, he's a character player, and I'm glad we have Dale Hunter.
He scored another big goal playoff overtime win a couple of years ago. We picked him to score the overtime goal again tonight. You talk about leadership, you got it in number 32, I'm sure.
He's a good man for us, and you know, he just came to play. He does his thing, and Jeff, I'm just happy for everybody.
Congratulations, David. You deserve it.
Thank you very much.
Caps General Manager David Poile, we're going to make our way through right here, right now. As you can imagine, a very, very busy Capitals dressing room, and if we don't get our wires turned, we'll get into the dressing room and try to get a couple of the players here with us. We're going to move right around. Let's go back upstairs to Mike and Al.
All right, Jeff, thanks very much. You know, there were certainly some heart-stopping moments throughout this game, but especially in sudden death overtime. I know my heart was in my throat when Propp got away on that breakaway over on the right wing side, and Peters was able to come up with a save. But let's take a look once again at the goal that has put the Capitals into the Patrick Division Finals against the New Jersey Devils, and Larry Murphy is the man who gets it started.
Once again, Craven misfiring to keep it in. Now, Scott Stevens was going to pick it up, and I guess it's maybe lucky he missed it. He kept it for Murphy, and before the Philadelphia defense can react, splitting down the middle is Dale Hunter. One move, two moves, and there is the opening. Hextall spreads it out, and Dale Hunter said he didn't know it until the last second, and that's what a good goal scorer will do, though. When you've got that breakaway situation, you take what the goaltender gives you, and obviously Hextall opened up on him, and Dale Hunter took advantage there. This is after Hextall had made some spectacular saves, the best stretch of goaltending I thought he played the entire series, and you wonder if the Capitals just thought that they were doomed when they hit those posts and saw Hextall come up with all those big saves. But Dale Hunter, who really has never lived that Capitals past, and maybe that's such an advantage. He never had to hear the fact that this team couldn't win under the big one, could not come through when they had to, that they were choke artists until he got here and until the team blew that lead in game four. Up until that time, he was able to go with a fresh slate, and I'm sure that has a factor in why he is a guy who delivers a winner.
All right, Jeff Rimmer is standing by downstairs now with Dave Christian. Jeff?
David, congratulations. A big win tonight. I know that you had some anxious moments in the first few seconds of overtime.
Well, we did. I think, I felt like our line, we had a lot of chances tonight. Could have scored some goals. Exall came up big when he had to. Well, they had a chance. I think Prop had an excellent chance in the overtime. So we've been waiting for this for a while. And I think if there was ever a roller coaster series, this was one. I mean, the momentum went back and forth all series long and even through this game.
Is there the monkey, is it off your back now for good?
Well, every day is a new day, every game's a new game, and that's the way we looked at it. We just went into the last three games hoping to survive and play one more, and I think that's the attitude that we had, and that's the attitude that we have to have and continue with that. Just, you know, we play each game and just try to survive, play another one, and I think we can do a lot and have some success if we play that way.
This is a team game, but what's Dale Hunter meant to this hockey club since coming over from the Nordiques?
He's added, I think this is the best group of forwards we've ever had, just with the addition of Dale, and we're strong through the middle because of him, and we've watched him. He scored some big goals for Quebec in playoffs before, and now he scored one for us. It's great to have him with us.
Congratulations, and good luck Monday against New Jersey.
Thank you.
Dave Christian of the Washington Capitals. We're going to try to get somebody else to come over here and join us. Bobby Gould, step right in over here.
Be glad to, huh?
Yeah. How about this one?
Oh, this is great. Great. The way we come back, that's the best feeling in the world. I mean, coming back like we did and fighting like we did. So that's a great feeling.
You get the monkey off your back now.
Yeah, we did a very good job of doing that. I mean, like, we showed a lot of character coming back three games down, and it was the monkey's done with. Nobody can say that we choked, because we come along and we played great hockey for three games in a row.
Does Dale Hunter add something to this team?
Oh, man, I tell you, he's worth his weight in gold out there. I tell you, back in Petrolia, they'll be having a few pops. His dad will be saying, that's my boy out there.
You remember Dale Hunter scoring any big goals back in growing up in hockey and the minors and the midget, juvenile and all that?
All the time. He was a clutch player when he played there. And, I watched him one game there in Montreal against Quebec. He scored the winner there 2 years ago. You can see, if you wanted to count on somebody, you could count on him getting the winning goal.
Congratulations.
Thanks very much, Jeff.
Bobby Gould of the Washington Capitals back upstairs now to Mike and Al. We'll return here to the dressing room in a moment.
All right, Jeff, thanks very much. You know, the Capitals have home ice advantage again in this series now as they'll continue on to play against the New Jersey Devils, and that means home games will start at the Capitol Center coming up on Monday night and Wednesday night with 7:30 start times and then 7 o'clock broadcast time, beginning with a Capitals report. So you'll see both those games on Home Team Sports. Tickets are available as well for both games here at the Capitol Center. And that's another thing with finishing second. You're well ahead of those Devils, and you'll have home ice on them, too.
That makes a big plus. And by the way, we also understand that the numbers for phone charge, 432-0200, those operators will be staying up, I think, until about 1 o'clock this morning. So if you're having trouble calling now and getting through, we understand 1 o'clock, at least 1 o'clock, maybe even later, the phone charge operators will be standing by. So if you want to get your tickets, you'll have ample opportunity tonight and, of course, tomorrow. And when Ticket Center outlets open up, you can pick them up there as well.
Makes a good point. I understand that for this particular game, once they put the playoff tickets for this game that we just finished here on sale the day after the Capitals had beaten the Flyers in Game 6, the tickets sold out in 12 minutes. So I don't think it took very long before that to happen. But the tickets for games E and F, that'll be Monday and Wednesday nights, are on sale now. And you can call phone charge at 432-0200. And as Al pointed out, they're going to stay open late tonight until 1 in the morning. And they're going to need to because of this overtime win that took so long to get completed. Let's check in again now with Jeff Rimmer.
Thanks, Mike. Well, there are a lot of characters on this hockey club, but I think the guy that stands up the most with a lot of character and a guy that's taking the heat from time to time, but I know he's savoring a big win, Caps coach Brian Murray. Brian, this is the highlight of this Capitals organization now to date.
Oh, I think it has to be, Jeff, and I thank you for those comments. We've been accused of a lot of things here, and we've maybe put ourselves in a position to be accused, but I thought we played tonight and in the latter part of this series awfully well and showed an awful lot of character, an awful lot of determination, and I think it's a just reward for the way the series went, and I'm really happy for our hockey team and for the organization.
What does this prove to the players in this dressing room as far as character, leadership, and coming from behind?
Well, a lot of people wrote them off. After we lost that lead in Philadelphia and lost the game in overtime, everybody had pretty well had written us off, and I think they just dug down. They understood it. They played as a group of 20 young men, and they played a system that they had a chance to bounce back. And we showed a lot of determination in doing that. And I think it proves to them now that they are winners, and this, I hope, will carry us some distance.
I know that you marveled with the acquisition of Dale Hunter last June. What's Dale Hunter mean to this hockey club over and above that goal tonight? And how about that goal?
Well, in the whole series, he was the guy that they were talking about, upset with. He bounced the goaltender. He bounced the defenseman. The size didn't really mean anything to him. He made the play tonight when it was 3-0 against us. He made the pass to Galley on a great pass, a great play. Galley scores. He gets a couple of goals. I mean, this is what we wanted for him, and I'm glad David made the trade for him. But a character person, a guy that I think has shown a lot of people what it's all about to win and make a major contribution in a win.
You don't get much time to savor the win. You play here in 48 hours. You got to start preparing tomorrow morning.
Well, that's the point now. And unfortunately, we had to go 7 games, and the league only gives you 1 day off. But we just have to do our best. Terry has spent a lot of time already on tapes in New Jersey, and we'll have meetings tomorrow and get ready to start again in another series. But this is certainly something we can build on now.
So there was no question the Capitals were going to advance then?
Well, we were ready if we were going to, Jeff.
Congratulations, Brian. You deserve it.
Thank you very much.
Caps coach Brian Murray, and let's go back upstairs to Mike and Al.
All right, Jeff, a lot of the fans still mingling here in the Capitol Center. They had a sellout crowd tonight, and a lot of them stayed around to watch some of the interviews that have been shown up on telescreen as Jeff Rimmer's been visiting down in the dressing room. And we'll return with more from the Capitol Center after we pause for these messages.
Sports, one of the veteran Washington Capitals with us, Mike Gartner. Mike, is that the Caps' new motto, no guts, no glory?
Yeah, I guess that's probably one of them. We feel tremendous right now, Jeff. I think that over the last couple of weeks, we've seen a lot of negative criticism about our hockey team. We've taken that choke label, I think, put it on the shelf for quite a while. Being down 3-1 and then down 3-0 in this game, I think we pulled together as a team and showed just the type of character that we always felt we had, but that we had to prove not only to ourselves, but to everyone else.
What you proved, though, too, is that you could come from behind, not only in this series, but in tonight's hockey game.
Absolutely. We'd done it a few times during the course of the season, and it was just a matter of us being able to put that into practice in the playoffs.
Is there any stopping this team now? You go on to face a New Jersey hockey club that's had some rest, but there's got to be some momentum you take into that series.
Oh, there's no question. There's a lot of momentum. We don't feel tired at all, really, right now. We're on a bit of an emotional high, and I think that everybody feels pretty good. We've played basically 4 lines throughout the series, and we feel pretty fresh right now. We're just looking for that first game against New Jersey.
Good luck and congratulations, Mike.
Thanks a lot, Jeff.
Mike Gartner of the Washington Capitals, certainly one of the key veterans on this team. I'm going to move along over here right now. And, Rod Langway, we're going to try to get the team captain, Rod Langway, here. We can maybe move in. I'll tell you what, we're going to go back upstairs to Mike and Al and then come back down here with the team captain of the Washington Capitals.
All right, Jeff, thanks very much. So the Caps will play the Jersey Devils Monday and Wednesday night. Tickets are available for both games, and both games will be seen here on Home Team Sports. 7 o'clock broadcast time, 7:30 start time for both Monday and Wednesday night against the New Jersey Devils, who barely got into the Patrick Division in the playoffs, and they did that on the very last night of the season, and it took an overtime win for them to be able to do it. But they got the job done, and it'll be the Caps and the Devils. Now, we talked about goaltending in this series and what a big role it was going to play and what a big role it did play. Ron Hextall showed us goaltending tonight that he had not shown during the entire series, and he played 65 minutes and 57 seconds in this game tonight, 35 saves, 5 goals against. He winds up at 2-4 on the series, taking the loss tonight. Pete Peters, 65-57 in the nets and 29 saves with 4 goals against. Pete winds up at 4-2. Pete Peters scared everybody a little bit with those leg cramps, if that's what they were. And Hextall, for a while, showed signs that he might be willing to turn the tables a little bit on the Capitals, and he sure stymied them with some impressive saves down the stretch.
Well, that's why I don't think the Capitals ever really, you know, they talked about his lack of confidence, but at no time did they ever really criticize him. I thought Rod Langway summed it up best, saying, you know, every hockey player goes through exactly what Ron Hextall goes through. One day you're a hero, the next day you're a zero. But at no time did they ever criticize him, because they know he is going to be a factor in this division and in this league for the next 8 to 10 years easy. And they're going to face another hot goaltender, a young one with size, and Sean Burke coming up.
Boy, that's for sure. Let's check in downstairs now. Jeff Rimmer is standing by with Rod Langway, the Capitals captain.
Rod, I remember back a few years ago, you were on the opposite side of Dale Hutter in Montreal when the Hutter scored an overtime goal, then with the Nordiques to sideline the Canadiens. I guess it feels a little bit better to be on this side.
That's for sure. I was on the ice, matter of fact, when Hunt scored in Montreal, and it was an overtime goal when he was playing for Quebec. So he's a clutch player, and that's one of the reasons that David went after him and got him on this club. And it's typical to have him come up with a big goal for us.
I think we can now say safely that there's a lot of character players on this hockey club.
Oh, we knew that, Jeff. I think you knew it, too. And we have a lot of heart. It's about, I would say, the biggest heart would be Scott Stevens and Pete Peters and some of the older players that have been around, because they were hurt. Scotty's got a bad shoulder, and, you know, they come up large. They wanted to play, and we were down 3-1. And we knew we were outplaying the team, Philly, and we're still losing. And all of a sudden, we just stuck together. We got some big goal scorers out of us. And, of course, Pete came up with some great saves for us. And we went over that hump. And now we're on to New Jersey and see what happens Monday night.
What was the feeling in the dressing room, actually on the bench, when you go down 3-0 in the second period, knowing that you've come back to fight in the series to even it up? What was the feeling, and what made this team turn it around?
I really don't know, Jeff. I mean, at that time, it was 1-0, and then all of a sudden, the wheel came off for a little bit. I mean, Howe just went through Hatchie's leg, and Pete had no chance in that shot. He was screened, and it hit the top shelf. Prop's goal was just a scramble. The puck popped to him, and honest to God, I thought we were going to get blown out of the rink, and the fans started booing us, and all of a sudden, we just made that one great play. As a matter of fact, I think it was Hunts that made the play to get it puck to Galley. Galley was off balance and just threw it at the net, and Hextall was between strides, it seemed, and then the wheel came back on, and we put pressure on. Then we got a little scramble in front with Kelly Miller and Mike Ridley, went in the net, and after that, we knew we had a chance, and we put the pressure on Philly, and I'm sure their little anal got a little tight for them.
Congratulations, Rod, and good luck.
Fast, but luck last year.
All right, let's go back upstairs for one final time. We'll come back here in a moment. In fact, we're not even going to go upstairs. We're going to talk to Scott Stevens right now. How's it feel, Scott?
Fantastic. It's the best feeling. It's probably the biggest win for me in my hockey career.
I guess there's no more word choke in this dressing room.
No way. I'll tell you, a lot of the stuff written about us and the people that have done it have really fueled us and motivated us. And that's what pushed us tonight, and the fans were fantastic. I'll tell you, we were down 3-0, and they were still right with us. They never booed us. And then when Gary Galley got his goal, they're right behind us, pushing us all the way. It was fantastic.
You don't get much time to savor this win, because you come right back in 24 hours to start preparing for next night.
Well, at least we're coming back and playing again. That's the main thing. I'd rather be playing hockey than just get my golf clubs out or my fishing pole.
You guys showed a lot of character, not only coming from behind in the series, but coming from behind tonight, down 3-0. It looked like the wheels were going to fall off.
Yeah, I'm very proud of this team and this organization. I've said it before. And, I mean, when we were down 3-1, no one was pointing the finger. No one was getting mad at each other. We were all pulling together. And I'll tell you, this is making us stronger down the stretch.
All right, congratulations. Enjoy the win and start preparing tomorrow for the next one.
Thanks, Jeff. Thanks a lot.
Back upstairs to Mike Bourns and Al Coker.
All right, Jeff, thanks very much. So that's the story tonight from the Capitol Center. The Washington Capitals win the game in sudden death overtime on a goal by Dale Hunter. They win the game 5-4. They win the series 4-3. Bring on the New Jersey Devils. The Capitals tonight showing all sorts of heart.
Heart! All you really need is heart. When the odds are saying you'll never win, when the grin should start, you gotta have hope. Mustn't sit around and mope. Nothing's half as bad as it may appear. Wait till next year and hope. You gotta have heart. Miles and miles and miles of heart. Oh, it's fine to be a genius, of course. heart. First you gotta